Hello, I'm Dr. Schulze, and this DVD is about natural first aid and natural trauma care. I'm going to teach you how to deal with all sorts of emergencies that happen in and around your home. Everything from bangs and bruises and bumps and burns to serious cuts and wounds and even serious disease emergencies like heart attacks, strokes, gallbladder attacks, appendicitis, and things such as that. Now, I know what you're thinking. I'm a doctor, and I can deal with these emergencies, and you're absolutely right. I spent decades in my clinic dealing with every emergency that you can imagine. But this video is not about me. It's about you, because I am going to teach you how to deal with 98% of the emergencies that happen in and around your home. See, I want to empower you. I want to educate you with the knowledge that I learned in my clinic so you don't have to run to the doctor and use drugs or worse, end up in the hospital emergency all the time, in the hospital emergency room, every time something happens around your house. In this video, I'm going to teach you how to build your own natural first aid kit. I'm going to talk to you about all the tools that you're going to need to deal with these emergencies. I'm going to tell you what herbs and natural medicines you're going to need in this first aid kit and some other surprises. See, I'm going to train you how to deal with trauma of injuries, wounds, and all sorts of emergencies that you're going to have around the house. I'm going to teach you how to deal with it emotionally and the physical part of the healing. And then I'm going to give you specifics of what I did in the clinic for each one of these types of emergencies, like bangs and bruises and bumps and burns, and how to deal with serious cuts and wounds, and even, like I just mentioned, how to deal with things like heart attacks and strokes and appendicitis and gallbladder attacks and all sorts of serious infection. I want to give you a caution right off the bat before we get into this video, and it's a legal caution. I want to train you how to take care of yourself, your family, your kids, your parents, your spouse, your loved ones, your relatives. But I'm not talking about strangers. See, in this world today, everybody wants to sue everybody. Nobody wants to take responsibility for themselves. And everybody wants to sue someone when things go wrong. Here's what I want you to do. I want you to know how to take care of all your friends and loved ones and family. People that you know won't sue you if something goes wrong because they don't want to take responsibility for themselves. So remember that. This is about you and your family and your loved ones. Okay, let me take my jacket off and let's get started. Okay. First off, I want to talk to you about how to emotionally deal with trauma. Then we're going to get into the actual physical specifics. But emotionally, there's one thing I want you to know right off the bat. It is never as bad as it looks. It's never as bad as it seems. When a person's hurt, they immediately go into shock, at least some level of shock. But you'll also go into a little bit of shock just having to deal with dropping everything, and all of a sudden, you have to deal with a drama and you have to deal with a trauma, but it is never as bad as it looks. You know, you need to have the person sit down immediately because often they'll pass out, hit their head, and have a worse trauma than their first trauma or their original trauma. So get the person to sit down, if not lie down. You know, often I drag people right into my kitchen and throw them right up on the counter or the kitchen table. Now they're lied down and I can deal with them. I'll never forget a story my dad told me that when he was young, he got kicked by a horse so badly that it opened up a wound right across his neck. He was bleeding severely. His mother grabbed him and brought him in the house and stuffed a washcloth on his neck to stop the bleeding. And when the doctor got by, he stitched him right up on the kitchen table. And I find that a lot of the times I drag people into the kitchen. That's where I have the herbs, the first aid kit, and I have tables and chairs and all the things that I might need. But what I'm trying to tell you is get the person to sit down before they fall down. And if necessary, get them to lie down, just like you have an examination table, and you can easily use the kitchen table or the kitchen counter to do that. And stay calm yourself. Again, it's never as bad as it looks or it seems, especially when bleeding is involved. It'll often look like someone's lost a quart of blood, but in reality, it's a couple tablespoons. So stay calm and be reassuring. One of the things that I do with people all the time is lie. Okay, whatever's going on, I lie first, and I always say, it's nothing. It's barely a scratch. It's no big deal. You're going to be fine. I can hardly see the wound. And I use all sorts of lies to calm the person down, okay, to get them to relax. It doesn't do any good to get them all excited or more upset and go, oh my God. So watch the expressions on your face and the words that you choose to use. But I usually go, come on, I've seen a lot worse than this. Just relax. We can deal with anything. This is very important to be positive. I always said in my clinic, nothing positive ever comes from being negative. Remember what I said? Nothing positive ever comes from being negative. So be incredibly positive, even if you have to tell a little bit of a white lie. This is no big deal. Ah, it's only a teeny bit of blood. It looks worse than it is. Whatever you can say to calm the person down. You know, most people, for any type of bump or bang or serious bruise and lump or any type of cut or wound, even minor ones, they go off to the hospital, they go off to the emergency room, and now you're going to end up dealing with doctors and drugs and all types of treatments that you'll often wish you didn't. You know, I always say with kids, kids would much rather be treated at home because they don't have to deal with strangers and all the drama and trauma and upsets that can happen in a hospital emergency room. But you know, most adults would too. So I want you to be able to deal with just about everything that happens around the house to avoid you all this physical and emotional pain and financial pain if you go to a hospital emergency room. And you know what? Even if you feel you can't deal with this, if you can't deal with it at all, have someone else you love and know watch this video who can deal with it. Designate someone in your household that's going to be the doctor when and if you need it. You know, and there may come times when you don't have a doctor readily available. You might be out in the middle of the nowhere. You know, often I travel to exotic places, to foreign countries that don't have medical care like we have in America. Or you might be out in the woods. You might be on a long hike. You might be out in the ocean, and you're going to have to deal with it. So the information in this DVD, you need to know. Probably all the trauma and medical emergencies that you'll have to deal with in your lifetime are going to be very minor. But it wouldn't hurt if someone in your house knows CPR and should get trained in that. Someone should know about bleeding control. And especially if you live near any water, like in Florida or California where I live, or you have a swimming pool in your backyard, someone should know how to resuscitate someone that's drowned. It's very important to learn the standard first aid treatments like CPR and bleeding control and breath resuscitation and drowning resuscitation. This is very important. I want you to be prepared because the reality is it's not if something like this happens in and around your home to yourself or someone you love. It's just a matter of when. Someone in your house is going to bang themselves, is going to cut themselves seriously, and you're going to have to know what to do. So let's get started, and I'm going to teach you how to handle everything. Before I start talking about the herbal medicines and the natural medicines that you're going to want to have in your kit, and also how to treat the various types of emergencies, I want to talk to you about tools, the tools that you're going to need in your first aid kit, because that's what we're doing first. We're building a first aid kit. Now, the first thing you're going to want is a good pair of tweezers. In fact, I suggest you have multiple pairs of tweezers, small, medium, and large tweezers. Sometimes they have curved ends. Sometimes they have very sharp pointed ends. Some just like pliers. You have needle nose pliers and regular pliers. You have a lot of different types of tweezers. So have two or three types and test them. Sometimes you need a real sharp tweezer to be able to get something small, like a small piece of glass out of the body. And another thing you're going to want to have is a good pair of glasses. I suggest going to the store and buying some reading glasses, some one-power glasses, and also some two, or if you can find them, three-power glasses. Now, with three-power glasses, you have to get this close. But if any of you have ever run into or had a run-in with a prickly pear cactus, it has very small, almost invisible, clear stickers on it. You're going to need a fine pair of tweezers and a high magnifying pair of glasses to find it, or a small piece of glass. Trust me, a small cactus thorn or a small piece of glass can feel like a 16-penny nail stuck into your body, but you're going to need high magnification glasses and a good tweezers. Now, also, you're going to want some scissors, and there's two types I like. One, you're going to definitely want to have a pair of scissors that have a blunt end, so you can't stab or cut the person. You don't want to make the trauma worse. And these are really good for going in and cutting things off, or cutting clothing off, or even cutting bandages off that you made that don't work. You know, often the first time I bandage a patient, I'm not happy with it. I'm not satisfied with it, and I cut it off, and usually the third time's the charm. And you also want to have a pair of pointed scissors, very important pointed scissors. Now, you're going to need to often clean up some blood or clean up a little bit of a mess. And some of the best ways to do that are cotton swabs. I like to use these especially around the eyes and the nose, where you wouldn't want something like a big rag. You want something small so you can get into an area and clean it. Often the first step in treating a wound, once you stop the bleeding, is cleaning it so you see what you're going to have to deal with. And if it's a bigger area, well, you can use anything general like gauze, cotton balls, or even cotton pads like these. I particularly like organic cotton. I'm fussy about the types of things I like to swab blood up with, but I suggest getting all types of cotton swabs, cotton balls, gauze, cotton pads. You're going to need them in your toolbox. Now, to dress a wound, you're going to need some tape. And one of my favorites is this waterproof tape. There's various kinds of waterproof tape, but any tape, the bottom line is, what is tape supposed to do? Stick. And you'd be surprised that the majority of first aid tapes that I find out there don't work at all. Sometimes I've even used electrical tape and duct tape. Scotch 33 is a great electrical tape, and I've used it on bodies, right on wounds. Don't worry about the infection, because I'm going to tell you something to put on there where you're never going to have an infection. So Scotch 33, this is Super 88, it's really thick. Or even duct tape. I put duct tape right over wounds. You don't know where you're going to be, and you don't know what you're going to have at hand. You can also use electrical and duct tape to make splints with cardboard. If someone has a broken bone, you can use them to dress wounds. These are great things for your first aid toolbox. Now, sure, you're going to want to have a selection of regular Band-Aids, and specifically, you're going to want to have some butterfly bandages. Now, if you can't find these in a drugstore, but I'm sure you can always make them yourself. It's no big secret. They're just something that has a small area where the wound is, and they come in packets like this where you have many, and you use these to close a wound. These are our natural replacement for stitches and staples that you won't need to have, and your wound will heal up better, and you'll never see a scar. But you can make them out of electrical tape, duct tape, and even waterproof tape, but these can come in really handy. Now, you may want to have something like a thermometer, but I find that most people are smart. When I ask them if they have a fever, they'll just say, yes, I'm hot. But it doesn't hurt to have a thermometer. Also, lighting. When you're there with your magnifier glasses, trying to find that small piece of glass with your scissors or with your tweezers, you're going to want to have some light. And I like these Surefire LED lights. They're nice and bright. They work really good. You can turn them and make it stay constant on while you're sitting there working with the tweezers, trying to find that small thing that's causing a lot of hurt. If you want something even better, although you might look a little strange like the mad scientist, you can find these headlamps. There's a lot of them available out there, and you just slip them on, and now you have a light everywhere you look. Now imagine, with my headlamp, with my geeky reading glasses, three power, with my fine tweezers, boy, I can see any of the smallest things that might be there. And sometimes you need to clean out a wound. Wounds get dirty. Finally, you may want to find some things that are specific to your area. Like for instance, in California at my ranch, we have a lot of rattlesnakes. Now, I have a pact and a deal with my rattlesnakes. They don't bother me, I don't bother them. I've stepped on them, they don't want to bite you, they don't want to hurt you. But venomous snake bites happen, bee stings, wasp stings, they happen. Scorpion bites, they happen. And often you have to have something to get it out of your body. And I find that this company called Sawyer makes my favorite one called the Extractor. And you can use this not just for rattlesnake bites or venomous snake bites, but you can use it for any time you want to pull something out of the body. I've pulled yucca needles out with these, and I've pulled cactus spines out. And it's a real great kit. All it is simply is something that looks like a hypodermic needle inside with a bunch of different suction tips that are in various sizes. Now, it works the opposite of the way you would think a hypodermic needle would. And I'll give you an example. You first pull the plunger out, because when you push the plunger in, it's not going in, it's going to suck out. That's what's so neat about the Extractor. Now, I don't have any stock in this company. I'm just telling you things that I learned in the clinic that work really good. Then you pick a head. Now, this one's for a venomous snake bite, but if you don't have fang marks, you don't need this. You have a small, a medium, and a large head, depending on what you're trying to pull out. I'm gonna pull out the medium head, and all you do is put it right in the end. Draw out the plunger, find the area that you want to draw something out of, and hold it tight against your body and push in that plunger. And look what happened. It's already sucking quite strongly on my body. In fact, I'm gonna have a big purple hickey there in a minute if I don't take it off. But if you have anything in there, like poison that you want to get out, or a bee sting, or a wasp sting, or even small cactus needles, or even if you have a boil, that you want to draw out the infection that's in there, this works great. And look at, I mean, that really sucks great. And I've used this a lot in the clinic and a lot in the field for first aid emergencies. So remember, anything that you can think of beyond this, add it in your big first aid kit. Now, I'm going to suggest that you make three first aid kits. The big one for your kitchen or your bathroom, a smaller one you might put in some type of cordura or nylon zipper bag for your car, for the trunk or the glove box, and even a smaller one that you're going to want to take out in the field when you go canoeing or hiking or out there on what I call my adventure treks when you're exploring the world. But whether you're out on an adventure trek, whether you're out in your car, or whether you're in your home, you want your first aid toolbox with all your great tools in it.
Oh yeah, I forgot about the box. Okay, here's the box I use that's in the kitchen or the bathroom. It's a big box, because A, I have a lot of tools, and now I have a lot of herbal medicine that I want to put in there. So just take some big box, put all your tools in it, put your herbal medicine in it, and label it, first aid kit. And this is the one for your house. You may even want to have a big one in your kitchen and a big one in your bathroom. I find that when you need it, you need it nearby, so you can't have too many first aid kits.
Now I want to talk about my favorite part, the herbal medicines that you need to have in your first aid kit. There used to be an herbalist named Samuel Thompson. In fact, people that follow his ideas are often referred to as Thompsonian herbalists. And Dr. John Christopher, one of my great herbal teachers, was certainly a Thompsonian style herbalist. Because Samuel Thompson used two herbs predominantly in his practice. He used cayenne and lobelia. Cayenne to stimulate and lobelia as a sedative and antispasmodic. And they're very important herbs. Cayenne is one of the first most important herbs to have in your herbal first aid kit. I mean, for serious problems, you can use it for heart attacks and strokes. Also, on any wound, it stops the bleeding.
But there's a more important reason I want you to have it in your herbal first aid kit, and it's to give it to the person who's injured immediately if you feel that they're going to pass out on you. And you can also give it to yourself if you feel like you're going to pass out. Because the one thing that'll happen when you have a dropper full of my cayenne tincture in your mouth is it will be impossible for you to go anywhere, to go to sleep, to pass out, to fall down, whatever. So if you feel like the person that you're treating is going to pass out or lose consciousness, just take a dropper full of my cayenne extract and put it in their mouth, and you will see a lot of blood rush to their face. Their face will turn red, and they won't be going anywhere. And if any time during the treatment of the first aid you feel like you might lose consciousness, you can take the cayenne tincture yourself. Now, you can also use cayenne powder for all the things I mentioned. You can put a teaspoon of cayenne powder in hot water for someone having a heart attack or someone having a stroke. This will stop it immediately. You can also pack the powder right on wounds. You can also give a pinch of it to the person you're treating or a pinch of it to yourself, and nobody will be going anywhere. But one of the reasons I like tinctures so much is they never go bad. Tinctures have a shelf life of about 50 years. They're quick. They assimilate quickly into the body. You put this into your mouth and you assimilate it in seconds, right into your bloodstream. You'll see your face turn red. You're there. So tinctures don't go bad. They can store in a first aid kit for years, and they work immediately. And they're also incredibly concentrated, very, very powerful. So for this reason, I love to have herbal extracts in my first aid kit. So also in your herbal first aid kit, you're going to want to have a sedative. And remember, I mentioned that lobelia was a powerful sedative and a powerful antispasmodic. So in my first aid kits, I have my nerve tonic. Now, my nerve tonic is 50% lobelia seed extract. And lobelia seed is the most potent and powerful part of the plant. And so this is a very powerful antispasmodic. Now with that, I add valerian root, skullcap, passion flower, hops, and the cohoshes, black and blue cohosh. And now you have a very powerful sedative and a very powerful antispasmodic that you might need in a first aid situation to calm a person down. If I could only have one herbal medicine in my first aid kit, listen up, if I could only have one herbal medicine in my first aid kit, it would be my anti-infection tincture, my anti-infection formula. This comes in so handy with all types of injuries, cuts and wounds. Let me tell you, this is the one extract that you can't be without in your herbal first aid kit. First of all, it disinfects wounds. When someone is hurt or cut, and I'm going to show you a little later in this DVD, I immediately flush the wound with my anti-infection formula. Okay, you want to flush the wound. You can use dropperfuls right in the wound immediately to disinfect. There's echinacea root and echinacea seed in here, which is a powerful antibacterial. You have garlic extract in here, garlic bulb, chopped fresh organic garlic right in here. And garlic destroys every known bacteria, gram-positive bacteria, gram-negative bacteria. It destroys staphylococcus or staph infections. It destroys every known virus, all the funguses. So it's a broad spectrum antibiotic, antiviral, antifungal, anti-anything that'll hurt you. It destroys all microorganisms that can hurt you. Also in here is golden seal root, another very, very powerful antiseptic to cleanse the wounds, and another lichen called usnea, again, another powerful antiseptic, and myrrh resin in here, a powerful tree sap, another antiseptic, and tea tree oil, another powerful antibacterial, antiviral, and antifungal. So the combination of all those herbs, let me tell you, when you flush a wound out with this, you are never going to get an infection. In my 3 decades of clinical practice, I never once saw a patient get an infection after the fact when I flushed their wound with my anti-infection extract. Okay, now what else is in this? Because it doesn't stop here. There's herbs that contain iodine naturally, not like betadine or inorganic iodine solutions that you'll find in the hospital or in the drugstores, but natural iodine from black walnut hulls and sea vegetables like kelp and dulse. So it's loaded with iodine. So you have the antibacterial nature of the iodine also in here. Now, it also has astringents in it that help close the wound back up, like bayberry root bark, a very powerful astringent. It also is loaded with habanero pepper. Remember, I already talked about cayenne. It stops bleeding. So with the astringent of the bayberry and the cayenne in here, when you flush a wound with this, it's immediately disinfected, but it also starts to tighten up and the bleeding stops. You'll watch the bleeding go down to a trickle. And finally, I also mentioned the myrrh gum already. I already mentioned that. But I also put in pine sap and other tree saps. Now, tree sap is tree blood. And tree blood, when you cut a tree is injured or wounded, it bleeds, but it bleeds sap. And the sap does two very important things. It closes the tree's injury, and it also is very antimicrobial also. Okay, but it seals the injury. Do you know that years ago, I was in the woods and I picked some sap up off a tree and put it in my mouth and tasted it, and it stuck to the roof of my mouth, and it was there for about 3 days until it peeled off, and I realized the power of sap. I also knew that tree sap, like cherry sap, is very disinfecting. It's been used for hundreds of years for colds and flu. But I also knew that once you got sap on you from just working with 2x4s and wood and doing some carpentry work, that once you got sap on you, it was very hard to get it off, and it was sticky. So I put a lot of tree sap in this formula, from myrrh gum to pine sap to other tree saps, for a lot of reasons. Okay, one is it's sticky and it glues wounds back together. Yep, this is what I call herbal body glue. And I can't tell you how many injuries I've glued and cuts I've glued back together. In fact, I had a man that was in a bad car accident and his whole patella, his kneecap was hanging off. I put it back and glued it back on with my anti-infection body glue. Now, beyond that, it disinfects, so you don't have to worry if maybe there's still a little debris, but we're going to talk about cleaning out wounds later. But also, it seals and coats the wound, and this is beautiful. It's like a liquid Band-Aid or a liquid protective sealing. If you take the anti-infection and you take it out like this and you put it on your body, okay, without dripping it too much, and then I blow on it, it'll evaporate very quickly. The reason is there's a lot of alcohol content in here. I extract these herbs with a high alcohol percentage. So once it's on you, it will evaporate. And once it evaporates, the alcohol dissipates, but the tree sap comes back out of solution and dries on your body. And if you do this at home, and then you'll feel that area, you'll see that it's a little bit shiny. But if you go to rub your finger across your body, it got stuck right there. Again, rub your finger and it sticks right there. Now you have sap covering the wound, sticking the wound, gluing the wound back together, but coating that wound so it protects it. So all the anti-infection properties are inside the wound, but at the same time, you have like a liquid bandage covering it. Now, I could talk for hours about this, one of my absolute favorite formula, but don't have a first aid kit without a bottle or two of your anti-infection formula in it. Another great product that you need to have, an herbal medicine for your first aid kit, is my deep tissue formula, either in the oil or the ointment or both. These are very important, and I'm going to tell you why. These are awesome for any bangs and bumps and bruising. The first thing this formula does is it contains wintergreen oil, which is a natural anti-inflammatory, reduces the inflammation in your body. It also contains botanical menthol, a very powerful extract from peppermint, from peppermint leaf that increases your circulation dramatically also. So you're reducing inflammation and you're increasing circulation. Two things that are very important with bumps and bangs and bruises, where you have blood coagulating and other fluids underneath and swelling, which causes your circulation to get stuck. Now, it also has habanero peppers, the hottest type of cayenne or hot peppers in it, which dramatically increase your circulation also. So here you have wintergreen oil to reduce the inflammation, a botanical menthol or very powerful peppermint to increase the circulation, along with cayenne or habanero peppers to increase the circulation too. So we're looking at increasing the circulation so that breaks up the coagulated blood and the bruising and all the congestion that happens while you have a bump or a bruise when you have a traumatic pound to your body. Now, it also has three of the greatest herbs known in the world for trauma to the body: arnica, calendula, and St. John's wort. Each of these herbs has become world famous for their ability to heal bangs and bruises. They've been used by bone setters in the mountains of Spain. These are very potent, powerful herbs for any time there's been an impact or a trauma to the body. So the deep tissue repair, whether it's in ointment or in the oil, is essential for your first aid kit. And I'm going to talk about it more when we talk about trauma to the body. Now, there's going to be some other herbal medicines that you're going to want to include in your first aid kit, but I'm going to talk about them specifically in the next section, where we're dealing with how to treat the emergencies, how to treat the trauma, how to treat the wounds, and how to treat the serious life-threatening emergencies that you can have in your household. Now we're going to start talking about treating injuries and trauma at home. One of the most common injuries that you'll find around the house are bangs, bumps, and bruises. This is by far what you're going to run into most of the time. You know, one of the worst I've ever seen in my entire clinical history was my own son, Arthur, who jumped off something. I wasn't there, hit his head. And by time I got to him, he had a bump, a purple bump on his head. You know, you hear people say the size of an egg, but it really isn't. His was literally the size of a large egg. I couldn't believe his skin hadn't split. And this was only within 2 minutes of him hitting himself in the head. But he hit himself really hard on the corner of a table. And before, in no time, it blew up to a large egg of swollen blood. And this is important. With bangs and bruises and bumps like this, you need to get to them immediately. And one of the top treatments you can do immediately is ice. You all need to have ice in your house. If you don't have an ice maker in your refrigerator, just go out and get a couple bags of ice and keep them in your refrigerator. Now, some people like to buy those cold packs, but you know what? They don't work anywhere near as good. If you're going to buy a cold pack, forget about it. You're better off with a bag of frozen peas or frozen carrots. But nothing works as good as just plain old ice. So always have a couple 8 or 10 pound bags of ice in your freezer, ready to use anytime you have an emergency. Because when someone hits themselves really hard or has any physical trauma to their body, the body will start swelling, blood will start getting stuck, and ice is an amazing healer. It almost reverses the damage of the impact. I have seen in my clinic and in my life literal miracles. When you put the ice on, it's almost like it goes back in time. It's almost like you reverse the injury and the problem goes away. If swelling gets bad enough, then you can get a split in the skin. Now you got to deal with an open wound. You got to deal with the blood. You got to deal with closing a wound. You can't get to a bang or a bump fast enough with your ice. It's got to be fast. It's got to be immediate, my friends. So have an ice, a bag or two of ice in your freezer at home all the time. Now, I'm going to show you how to make my favorite way to apply ice to the body. Now, it isn't in some fancy ice bag. And again, it's not in one of those frozen gel packs or anything like that. It's not in one of those quick clothes, cold devices that you hit and it freezes and gets cold. Those all work, but I'm going to show you something better. It's just how to make an ice bag that gets really cold at home to put on a wound. The first thing you need is any dishcloth or a tea towel. And this is something that everybody has at home in their kitchen. And again, I've learned pretty much all my first aid right in the kitchen. And the second thing you do is dump an amount of ice in it. Now you can just take the ice and put about, at least 5 good handfuls of ice in the middle of this towel. Depending on the size of the area you want to treat, but get some ice in this towel. Now the next thing you do once you've loaded the towel is just kind of put it together. Fold it in half. I got my ice in the middle, and now I'm gathering it, and I have my ice here in the middle. Now, what you can do is you can take a string, but I find rubber bands work really good, and just put yourself a rubber band around it a couple times, and if you feel you want something more, well, put another rubber band. Rubber bands work really good on the dishcloth or tea towel, and now you have a bag of ice, but I'm not done. Now the next thing you want to do is you want to break up this ice. This isn't high tech. Okay, you smash the ice on a good marble or granite countertop like this. Smash your ice up and see, now you got it nice and flat. And crushed ice or smashed ice will also bend around the body more. If you have big ice cubes in there, that doesn't work. It also breaks down the ice, and now you have more frozen surface here. And I can feel this is already getting cold, but not cold enough for Dr. Schulze. What I like to do next is usually I just run to the faucet and run it under the faucet, but I can't get my video camera over there, so I'm just gonna pour some water over the area of the cloth and get this whole area where the ice is wet. Okay, now we got crushed ice in a tea towel, really wet, and now it's starting to get really, really cold. Now you want to apply this homemade ice bag, which is freezing cold right now, immediately to the banged or bumped area. Hold it right on it and put a little pressure if you need to. At first, the person might cry or yell or go, oh, that's cold. Leave it on. They will thank you later. Okay, how long do you keep it on for? Minimum of 5 minutes. I like 8 minutes, but some people now, even doctors are saying 20 minutes. It gets really cold, but not too long because you can actually damage the body by freezing it. Now this right now, I've had this on for about 20 seconds. It is really, really cold. Let me tell you, the fake gel packs don't work well. The instant cold thing's not cold. But you take ice, you put it in a tea towel like this, you crush it up and smash it up, and you pour water over it and you put it on the body. Right now, 30 seconds later, my hand really hurts from the ice. Now, if you're banged or bruised, don't worry about it, because this will make the pain go away. But also, more importantly, you will stop the area from getting so big that the skin will break or burst. My CEO was over here at my house last year with his daughter Isabella, and she banged herself and almost cut herself a little bit, but it got so big it looked like it was going to burst. Then, like I said, we have to deal with much more trauma, but I made an ice bag and put it on her head, and sure enough, within just a few minutes, that swelling went down, the blood didn't get stuck, the fluid didn't get stuck, the chi or the energy or the prana didn't get stuck. Ice is great for unblocking, which is a major part of healing, and reducing the inflammation in an area that has been traumatized. Okay, you want to use the ice on and off repeatedly for at least a couple hours, if not 3 or 4 hours. And you might even use that ice bag on and off throughout the night. But the next day,
Now you can start going, especially after 24 hours, you can start going into hot and cold repetitions, like a hot and cold shower. Now, if any of you in your shower have one of those wands, that works even better. You can use the faucet under your sink and change the hot and cold. If you have a hot tub or a jacuzzi, you can get in the hot tub and have the ice pack sitting on the edge of the hot tub. But the idea is you put hot water on the area and then cold water on the area and alternate them back and forth. Now, the way to do it in a shower, if you have a wand, is to turn the hot and cold water both on and make it a nice hot shower. Then turn the hot water all the way off. Now, you're just going to manipulate the hot water on and off. So you turn it off and let full cold go on the area that's injured. Then turn the hot water back on for a minute, as hot as you can stand it. Then turn it off for a minute and take a nice cold shower of that area. Then on and repeat 7 colds and 7 hots. And that alternating hot and cold is going to do something very magical. When you put hot water on the body, it brings the blood to the surface. That's why the skin turns red. And when you put cold water or ice on the body, the skin turns white because it drives the blood deep in your body. And alternating the hot and cold brings the blood to the surface, pushes the blood back down. It forces the circulation. And anytime you force the circulation, you force the healing. And using herbs like cayenne tincture and lobelia and adding hot and cold therapy, it's the most powerful way I know to move blood in your body. And when you move blood, you free up the blockage and you reduce the drama and the trauma from injuries, especially bangs, bumps, and bruises. Now, if you're using a jacuzzi, just get your whole body in the jacuzzi, but then pull the area out, if it's your arm or whatever, and put ice on it for 8 minutes. Then take it and put it back in the jacuzzi. Or you can do 1 minute back and forth, but repeat it about 7 times. And you can even do it under the kitchen sink if it's your hand. But we're talking about bumps, bangs, and bruises. And I've seen major bumps and traumas that would have split, that would have required stitches, that would have been horrible injuries, turned into almost absolutely nothing by the use of making your ice bag, bringing in some cayenne and nerve tonic, and then the next day and the day after doing hot and cold. And the next thing you're going to know, in 2 or 3 days, it's almost gone. Ah, one more very important thing, your deep tissue. You can put this on immediately too. Once you've used your ice right off the bat, and you've done that on and off and on and off, the next thing I want you to do is coat the area with your deep tissue oil or your deep tissue ointment. Remember, this increases circulation, reduces inflammation, and the 3 herbs, arnica, St. John's wort, and calendula, are especially for trauma. You could call this trauma medicine. Now, when I have someone with a bump on their head and it's close to their eye, it doesn't feel good to get my deep tissue oil or ointment in your eye or in sensitive areas of the body. So I like to apply it with my finger or a Q-tip, because a lot of times kids bang themselves right on their forehead. I will put a dab of this on and then move it around with a Q-tip, but make sure I keep it out of their eye. Now, they still might say it's in my eye because the vapors are so strong, they're going to move around and it's going to feel blinding, so just tell them to close their eye for a half hour. And then once you get the deep tissue on there, that's going to increase the circulation, reduce the inflammation, and deal with the trauma, then you continue to go back and forth with your ice. But as soon as possible, get the deep tissue on the area too. So let's look at that. Make your ice bag, smash it up, make it in a tea towel with rubber bands, smash it up. Wet it with some water, get a real cold ice bag, and get it on the bump or bruise immediately. Once it's on there for 8 minutes, take it off and get your deep tissue oil or repair on that area. That's going to work right hand in hand with the ice to increase the circulation, reduce the inflammation, and deal with the trauma. And then if the person needs it, if they're going to pass out or faint, get them a little cayenne tincture. And if they need to go the other way and relax, get them a little nerve tonic. And now you've dealt with all the bangs and bumps and forget bruises because you won't even have any if you follow this routine. I've seen where I knew it was going to be a purple black eye and the black eye never happened because of getting in there and increasing the circulation right away. And more importantly, I've seen many that would have split if they were just allowed to swell while you were in the car on the way to the hospital emergency room. And I kept them from splitting by using this routine. This routine right here will save you from the majority of trauma that you get in and around the house, which is bangs, bumps, and bruises. Now let's talk about treating burns, because burns are something that happen to everybody, and especially happen around the house and often happen in the kitchen. But let me give you a word of warning before we talk about burns. Sometimes some of my patients have been hurt worse by trying to put the fire out than just getting away from the fire. So if you have a kitchen fire or a fire in the house or garage or anywhere you are, the first most important thing is to get out. You can rebuild the kitchen, you can remodel the garage, but you only have one body. Just get out. Get away from the fire, because that's what hurts you and that's what can kill you. So get away. You can always yell to someone else to call 911, but there's nothing worse than being burnt and then trying to put the fire out and getting burnt much worse. So forget about the fire and think about yourself. Okay, so what do we do about burns? Well, one of the first things, this might sound a little obvious, is put the fire out. Okay, and often you can do that just by running the area under cold water. You know that often when you're burnt, the tissue, the meat of your body keeps cooking, and this is where burns can get really dangerous. So as soon as you're burned, get cold water on it. Run to the sink and put cold water on it. And the next best thing would be to make one of those ice bags and put it right on the burn. Okay, you gotta stop the cooking. You have to stop the fire. So remember my first two important things. Don't try to put the fire out. Get out. Get away from the fire. Tell someone else to do it because you've already been injured. And the second thing, get cold water and ice on that burn immediately as fast as possible to stop the cooking of your flesh. Okay, if it's not a serious burn, and it's just like a first degree burn or even a second degree burn, one of the things that I like to do is use my jojoba and tea tree oil on the burn. You can use it in either the oil or the ointment. There's a couple things that are very important about jojoba oil, and that's that it penetrates through the skin. Most oils just swim around on top of the skin, but jojoba oil is actually an ester, and it does penetrate deeply through all layers of your skin. And with it is the tea tree oil, which is an antibacterial, an antiviral, and an antifungal, and it's great burn treatment. But if you've been burnt more severely, another great treatment is aloe vera. People use aloe vera for sunburns, and it works amazing. There's all types of aloe vera creams and lotions on the market that are beautiful for sunburns or any type of burn. They put the fire out. But most of them, unfortunately, are garbage. They look like fluorescent blue hair setting gel. Now, it says on them 99% aloe vera, pure aloe vera, but what they mean is the 1% that's in there is 99% pure. They're garbage. There's very few good ones on the market. You'll find a couple good ones in a health food store. But better than that, anybody can have their own aloe vera cactus, like this one right here, that you can have right in your kitchen, right in your clinic, anywhere you want, and then it's there to use anytime you need aloe vera. And I'm going to show you how to do that, because I used fresh aloe vera on all my patients' burns. In fact, in my clinic in Malibu, I had a 40-year-old aloe vera growing outside my clinic window, and I used it to treat patients for almost 20 years in that particular clinic. The older the aloe vera, the more potent it is. This aloe vera is not that old, so it wouldn't be that potent. So grow them as big as you can. If you live in a nice area like Florida or California, well, you can just dig them and put them in the ground outside, and they'll love it and they'll grow wild.
If you live in colder climates, well, they won't do well, but you can grow them in the house and use a plant grow light. But you always want to have an aloe vera cactus around. Now, sometimes they're the yellow flowered or the official variety. The one in Malibu was another variety. It was aloe vera, some different possible species. And it was an orange flowered one, and that one worked just as good. Any type of aloe plant works really good for healing wounds. There's many chemicals in aloe, one of them, aloin or allantoin, that is a cell proliferant. It helps your cells grow back 5 to 10 times faster than normal. So let me show you how to do it. You simply just cut a leaf off. You take any type of knife and cut a leaf off, and they come off pretty easy. They almost snap off, and now you have a leaf. And you see that the leaf has a skin on the outside and all this gel on the inside. You can see the gel here. Now I'm going to put this down on the cutting board, because what you want to do next, it's really quite simple. Depending on the size of the area you want to treat, but say like you burnt your finger or your arm getting something in and out of the oven, well, cut yourself a 2 or 3 inch piece, cut it off, throw it over so it's on a flat surface, and cut off the edge. And cut the edge off on the other side. And now what you want to do, you can see all the goo starting to come out of there. Now what you want to do, if you have a good fillet knife, it works best, but you just want to fillet off the skin and expose the gel like that. Oh, you can see how slimy and good it's getting. Now, what you can do on top of that is fillet off the other side, or you can leave that skin on. So let's look at how we would put this aloe vera right on a burn. Well, I'm going to want a little thinner piece because it's for my hand. So I'm just going to slice a piece of this gel right off here and just take a piece of this nice gel. Look at that beautiful stuff, just like this. Okay, now I'm going to put this right on my hand here, imagining that is the burned area. The next thing you want to do is cover it with some type of gauze pad. Now, I have these NexCare pads here, but they come individual like this, and they're great pads, but you can use any type of gauze. You could use a piece of an old t-shirt and just put it over the wound and over the aloe, over the burn, and over the aloe, just like this. The next thing you do is you just take some pieces of tape and take the tape, and it's always hard bandaging yourself, and you're getting the idea though, and take this tape and wrap it around. I usually like to get a first couple pieces of tape on, like this, and get it down tight. Now I got an area to work with and that aloe's in there. Now I can go ahead and put further pieces of tape over it, tape it closed, and now I have the aloe taped right down to my skin. And this is going to be magical for the burn. So let's just review for a minute. The first rule when you're burned is get out of the fire. Don't try to put the fire out. Let someone else put the fire out or call 911. Get out of the fire and flush the wound with cold water immediately. The second thing you want to do is put some ice on it. Stop the burning. Stop the cooking of that area. Then, once it stops cooking, you can cover the area with some jojoba and tea tree oil, the oil or the ointment, or even use some aloe vera and slice it up, put the gel on like I did and tape it to the body. Now, the next day, you're going to notice that the aloe's gone. Maybe in a few hours, it's absorbed right into your body. Put another fresh piece on and keep doing that for 3 or 4 days. And the next thing you're going to know, the burn is gone. Now I'm going to talk about treating cuts and open wounds. And I want you to remember the first thing way back at the beginning of the video where I said that it's really not as bad as it looks. Often when you cut your hand or your face, it looks like a ton of blood is coming out. It looks like a quart or a liter of blood, but it's really probably less than a teaspoon. At the most, a tablespoon. But a little blood goes a long way. It's something we usually want to be on the inside of our body, not see on the outside of our body. But you got to trust me on this one. It's almost always not a big deal. Okay, so if it is, a big deal. And you realize right away, this is more than I can handle. You know what to do? Call 911. Let me tell you that I always go on and on and on about the butchery of medical doctors. But the one place medicine excels is probably the 1% of medicine, which is trauma medicine. So if you're in over your head, don't worry about it. Call 911. Hey, if you're in a bad auto accident and part of you is on one side of the freeway and your leg is on the other side, I want trauma surgery. I want neurosurgeons, okay? This is the time when we want to use medical doctors and all that they have available for us. But I'm talking about cutting yourself with a knife around the house, with a box cutter, you're opening a box, or some wound or gash in your body. You can take care of yourself. So the first thing you want to do is apply pressure to the body. This will stop the bleeding, and it also covers up the wound for a minute so the person that's hurt and you can have a little breath for a minute without looking at it. So just cover it up, put pressure on it. Now you can use a piece of gauze, you can use your shirt, you can use a tea towel, you can use paper towels. It doesn't matter, but you just cover the wound and put some pressure on it. This alone usually stops the bleeding. Now that you've put pressure on it, if you can, ask the person to hold this. Now remember way back at the beginning of the video when I talked about trauma, the other thing was get that person to sit down or lie them down. Very important, because we don't want them falling down, hitting their head, and causing a worse injury. So put pressure on the wound, hold it tight, stop the bleeding, be reassuring, say, look, it's not that bad, it's only a nick. Don't worry, this is something we can fix. Relax. Okay, you're putting pressure on the wound as you're saying that. The next thing you want to do, if the person's passing out or being faint, is give them some cayenne tincture. This will wake them right back up and you won't lose them and it'll make them behave. If they're all panicky and freaked out and having an anxiety attack or a panic attack, go the other way and give them some nerve tonic and relax them a little bit and reassure them more. Say, look, this is not a big deal. Just relax. The whole time you're keeping the pressure on the wound. Now, the next thing you want to do is take a look at it. And hopefully you're up for this. And if you're not, take a little cayenne tincture yourself. But that's the next thing we're going to do. Now, usually the bleeding stopped. If you take the pressure off and the piece of material or the cloth or your shirt or the gauze off, and there's a lot of blood spurting, well, you've hit an artery. Now, it's very unlikely to hit an artery, very difficult to hit an artery. That usually happens in major, major trauma and car accidents. But it's very hard. Usually you've hit a vein, maybe not even that, maybe just a small capillary. But as long as there's no spurting blood, you're fine. Just keep the pressure on. If it's still bleeding, keep a little pressure on. Okay, the next thing you want to do is flush the wound with the anti-infection tincture. This is going to clean it, this is going to disinfect it immediately, and this is also going to slow down, if not stop, the bleeding. So you get your anti-infection tincture out and you flush the wound with one dropperful, two dropperfuls, repeated dropperfuls. Just make a mess and cover that area, and if the bleeding's still trickling a little bit, you can go ahead and apply more pressure. But that gives you a minute to take a look at it to see, okay, this is something we can deal with, it's not a big deal. I've dealt with so many people that have sliced their body seriously open, from little kitchen knife accidents to big gashes with woodworking tools, and to auto accidents where pieces were off and I just glued them back on and put them back together. So flush it with the anti-infection. Okay, now the bleeding stopped, and now you want to take a look at the wound. Now, I always suggest to make sure that the person's sitting down and relaxed and has their nerve tonic or their cayenne to keep them conscious. And now it's time to check it out. Let's see how bad it is. Usually for that, you want to put on a pair of reading glasses again so you can really get a close-up look. You could use a magnifying glass, but the problem is now you've used up one of your hands. So I like using reading glasses for checking it out. And now you got to take a look at it. Now, hopefully you just flushed it out, and if it was with a kitchen knife or even a rusty jackknife, it doesn't matter, you're going to be fine. But if you happen to have debris in the wound, before you go any further, now's the time you need to clean it out. This is a little bit painful sometimes. Generally speaking, 90% of the time, you don't have to do any cleaning. But if there's a lot of dirt in the abrasion or the cut, or a person fell in stones or asphalt, often you have to do a little cleaning. And the first thing you do is you put on your glasses. The next thing you do is get out a tweezers or a small toothbrush. I know Navy corpsmen use a scrub brush on road rash and wounds. And you got to debride it. You got to clean out anything that's in there. You don't want to seal up or close up this room with foreign particles in it, because then you're going to get an infection. But like I said, 95% of the time, don't worry about this. It's only if you see asphalt and grass and foreign material in there, well, you got to do some cleaning. And the way you do that, again, is just squirt the anti-infection and use your glasses with your tweezer or your toothbrush. You can even use a little bit of gauze like this if a toothbrush is too intense, but you got to get the foreign material out of there. You can even press really hard on the area around the wound or on the other hand or the person's earlobe or something to distract them. Give them some nerve tonic. If you have a third person, have them give them a little neck and shoulder massage, a little release, and do some humming, whatever it takes, but I want to get them distracted if I have to clean it out a little bit. The final thing we do is flush it with more anti-infection, clean the area around it, and start taping and bandaging it up. Okay, now I'm going to demonstrate this on a mango and on a banana so you can see how I do it in action. Well, we've had a couple pretty serious cut and wounds here today in the kitchen. We have Mr. Mango and Mr. Banana have cut themselves pretty good. I thought I would use these to demonstrate to you what it looks like and what it's like when you're treating someone that has a good serious cut. Okay, remember the first thing we do, because we're gonna have blood, is put some pressure on it. Put pressure on this cut and hold it there and reassure the person that everything's okay. Ah, it's not as bad as it looks. It's not that much blood, it just looks like a lot. Relax, take a deep breath. It's all fine, keeping the pressure on. And remember, now's the time to give them a good dose of cayenne tincture if it looks like they're going to pass out, or give them a nice dose of the nerve tincture if it looks like they need to relax, if they're having panic or anxiety. Now, what's a good dose? Well, one dropperful of the cayenne tincture goes a long, long, long way. With the nerve tincture, go ahead and use 2, 3, 4, or 5 dropperfuls. It's all fine. The next thing you do is once you take the pressure off, you quickly flush the wound with the anti-infection tincture. So basically what I'm going to do is, as much as possible, squirt it right in the cut. Squirt it right in there. And really flood and flush this cut and fill it up. And if it's the banana, same thing. Flush it. If you can get the dropper in near the cut, do it and squirt hard. As you can see, I'm squirting hard and flooding this cut. You can see it bubbling out, flushing it. Flushing these wounds with this tincture, it'll be dropping all over the place and coming out. That's all fine and good. And if necessary, you can apply a little more pressure. You can apply a little pressure if it's still bleeding. But right now, the bleeding's really going to stop and slow down on these wounds. Pretty much come to no bleeding at all. Now, you don't want to rub a lot on the wound. You're just holding pressure. But now the bleeding is stopped. Now we want to take a look at what's going on. And this is another good time that you want the person to sit down, stay down, or lie down. Because now we have to examine. And like I said, if there's a third person around, have them squeeze their other hand or other arm, or give them a little neck shoulder. Or even some footwork is great, because it takes all the energy out of your head. It's hard to be panicking when someone's giving you some good, deep footwork. And now we want to look at this wound. Sometimes we need to take a little bit of a cotton swab and just clean it up a little bit to see what we got. But I don't like messing with the wounds much, okay? People do a lot more cleaning than is really necessary to do. After that, we might have to really take something out of the wound. Like I said, 95% of the times, no. Don't worry about if there's something microscopic in there. Forget about it. Anything microscopic, any germ, any bacteria, any virus, any fungus, any antigen, any pathogen, they're dead now. That anti-infection killed them. It's going to work. So now I'm going to look, and it looks good to me. Close enough. You don't have to be an inspector. You don't have to get a microscope. But if you see something in there, like here, I'm looking in here, I see something. Okay, there's a little stone. I'm going to pull that out. Now, don't go jabbing the tweezers in. If you're going to hurt this person like that, you might as well send them to the emergency room at a hospital where they'll torture them to death by cleaning their wound. And go ahead, and if you see something, get rid of it. Pull it out. Often, if there's wood involved, you get splinters. And if you see a splinter, go in and just pull the splinter out. Once a person's been cut like this, usually the nerve endings have been cut and they don't feel anything. So now you have a little window of time where you can work with them a little bit. And if necessary, while you're in there and you've cleaned it out, flush it again. Flush it again. Like that, flush it again with your anti-infection. See how I'm flushing that out? Flush the wound out. Now we know it's clean. Now, if you have to on a big wound, sometimes you have to get out the toothbrush, but this is painful. Give them a little more. Maybe before you do this, you've stopped the bleeding. There's no problem with leaving it open a little bit. Go ahead and get a friend that can give them a little massage or do some footwork, because this can hurt. Sometimes on a cut it doesn't hurt, but on road rash or a brush burn, it really hurts. And then just lightly, you might have to clean it just a little bit. But like I said, that's rare. That's 5% of the time. Really, right now, we're ready to close this wound back up. And this is where you can use tape, but you can also use butterfly bandages, which are bandages like this with a thinner area in the middle. They come in packages like this. You can also use these new, I found them, wound closure strips, which are breathable and good, and they're thin. The thing is Band-Aids aren't good enough here. You need some good adhesive. So if I'm going to close the wound, one of the ways you do it, now at this point, you can't be afraid to manhandle the person. You can't be afraid to grab that wound area. Now, if you got a lot of anti-infection around, or there was a lot of blood around, go ahead and take some alcohol on a cotton swab now and clean the area, simply because the bandages won't stick to the anti-infection a lot, and they won't stick if there's a lot of blood there. So go ahead and clean the area around the cut. Don't get the alcohol in it. We already got it clean. You're just cleaning the skin around it, so now the bandages that we put on will adhere. And give it a minute, because that alcohol has to evaporate now. I'm going to even give a little blow on it. So now we got the bleeding is stopped. The wound is disinfected, and now we just have to put it back together. Now, in a hospital, they would use stitches or staples, but we use glue, which is our anti-infection, and we use tape. Now, one thing I have found, and this has been proven in many medical studies, is if you go in and trim this wound up and cut away flesh, it will not heal as well. But torn skin, just like a piece of splintered wood, when you put it back together like this, it heals much better. It heals much faster. Okay? It's just like putting it right back together, like you have a piece of splintered wood. You know how you can put it back together and glue it? Okay, you're putting it back together. It heals better. It heals quicker. And your tendency is you won't have a scar at all. So the worst thing you want to do is trim that out or get aggressive or go to the hospital and have a doctor do that. Just stick it back together. So now we're ready to start taping it back together. And what I like to do is put a little more glue in there, unless you feel like you have plenty of it. But don't get it everywhere now, because now we want to tape. But put some glue in there. Okay, this is my anti-infection glue. Remember, the tree resins are like glue. Then you take one of your butterfly bandages, and this is where you have to be a little aggressive. You have to squeeze the area back together. put the bandage on one side like this, and then pull it together and put the bandage down. See how it drew that area back together. And then press on the bandage a little bit. And I'm going to do that again. First, I put it over here. Squeeze the area back together and put it on. And press it down a little bit. You can see how now that area is closed up really nicely. Now, as you can see already, these strips started peeling away and falling off, and the wound opened up a little bit. No big deal. Remember I said earlier, third time's a charm. Wounds don't always behave like you want them to. So one of the reasons that happened is because the mango skin is a little wet and there's a little anti-infection on it. So if this was a wound, you might have to clean it a little more. But I'm going to go to one of these bigger strips now so I can really get some adhering. Again, now you push the wound together and get the strip on like this. Ah, this is working much better. You can see how that closed up really nicely. And do the same again down here. But remember, right before you tape it, you gotta push that wound together and then tape it down. Now at this point, I always do something else because see how that's drawn together really tightly? But I like to do a little more because often the last thing I want to happen is just to loosen up. Now again, these are breathable wound closure strips, but you could have done this with duct tape, electrical tape, but there's nothing wrong with getting some good supplies out of the pharmacy. But now what I wanna do is back up the strength of these strips with some additional tape. Okay, because I don't want those pulling loose. So I want to tape them down. And once they're taped down good, well, that's almost all you need to do. If you feel that you want to cover it, you can. But I like to let wounds breathe. If they need to, weep. And if they need to, get air circulation. So this person shouldn't be going anywhere right now. If they have a split this long or a cut this long in their leg or their knee or their arm, they shouldn't be doing anything. Even if this cut's only a quarter of an inch long in their finger, now the day's done. No matter what time it is, it's time to go watch a DVD, relax, listen to some music, do some meditation, whatever. But work's done for a day or two now. We got to let this heal. I'm going to show you the same thing. I'm going to repeat it here with the banana. Now, with the banana, it's possible that our strips are going to work, our butterfly bandages. But again, we got to put it together. And when you push it together, well, some anti-infection might come out and some extra blood might come out. But we need to get it together. Now's the time. And I used a banana because bananas are harder. They're a little more like the body to get together. Now, I'm not happy with that. And, you know, you might have to move the person around. And you can see with this, we got banana coming out. Now, sometimes with a deep cut, you actually get fat and tissue coming out of the wound, unidentifiable material. That's okay. So you can clean that up a little bit. And I'm going to use one of my bigger strips here because I can see that I need some industrial strength closing. So I'm going to put that on and see it already messed up. And you know what? That's the second time. I don't like it. But remember I said third time's a charm. Bandaging the body is not the easiest thing to do in the world. So don't worry about doing it two, three, four times. Don't stop till you feel good about it and get it right. I wasn't happy with that last taping, so I'm just going to do it again. Remember, this person now is relaxed. They're sitting or lying down. Maybe someone's even rubbing their feet. And now I want to get a better taping on this. So again, I'm going to get one side of it stuck well down here, close the wound with my fingers, and put the other piece of tape on. See how tight that came together now? Now again, if there's a little blood or you won't have pus yet, but sometimes you can have blood or plasma coming out, just clean it up. Now I got it good and tight. Now I'm going to go ahead and do another one. This is quite a big wound, and it's deep wound. A banana really shows you what a deep wound is like because that's if you cut through a lot of layers of your skin. And now pinch it together
and close it. Now you can tell the person before you pinch it together to take a deep breath, because sometimes it's going to be a little traumatic to them because you're touching and handling the area that's injured. But usually right now they're in a little bit of shock, and you can get away with something that you wouldn't be able to get away with an hour from now. And then this last area, well, I'm going to pinch it together, but you can see there's a little plasma, a little debris coming out of there. I'm going to clean that up for a minute, and so I got a nice contact. I'm going to dry this finger, arm, or leg a little bit here. Then I'm going to apply my tape to the bottom, get a good pinch together, draw it together, and get that tape down. And I would say that this person here is not even going to have a scar. You can clean the wound a little bit like this. And now remember your backup tape. On a wound like this, I'm going to want to take my tape here and back up these butterfly bandages or this wound closure strip because I want a backup. I don't totally trust him, and that felt a little weak there, so I'm going to put on a double backup. Really get this down. The same thing on this side. You can take a piece of tape, get the size you need, and cover it up this way, just like this. I like to leave the wound open as possible, like I said earlier, so it can breathe. Back that tape up. Now, on difficult areas, or where the wound isn't behaving well, I've been known to tape it again on top, put more closure strips on and more butterfly bandages. Now, some wounds aren't like cuts. They're not as neat and pretty as these. This person won't need any stitches, won't need any staples, and the scar, well, they're not going to have one. But some wounds are a little different. Let me see if I can demonstrate that. It's wonderful if people just cut themselves in the kitchen with a knife, and you can do a job like this, and they'll have no scar, and it all comes back together. But unfortunately, some people, it looks a little more like this. They got ripped pieces of skin. This is more of a cut, what you'll experience. This is more of a wound. So I just want to show you what I do for wounds, using all the same procedures. The first thing with a wound, you have an open area, is again, make sure you get plenty of your anti-infection in here, flooding and flushing the area. But now remember, now we're gluing. And simply what I do is make sure there's no debris in there, check it. Put your anti-infection in and just put the piece back. Okay, just glue it down. Just put the flap of skin. I put people's whole kneecaps back on this way. And if you have a piece that's missing or come off, well, I'm a believer. I always give it a shot. Why not? All we're doing is putting a jigsaw puzzle back together. Put a little glue, your anti-infection glue on here, and try to fit the piece back. I would do it just like that. Okay, now I've put the pieces in parts. You might have an area, well, it's a mess, and there might be a little bit of a hole. No problem, but I try to stuff every little bit like that back in. I try to use it all. If the skin's going to die, let it die. And then do a little bit of a cleanup job. And look at that. That was looking horrible a few minutes ago, and now it looks like it's almost back together. And then carefully, again, with your wound strips or butterfly bandages, put it all back together. Oh, it might look a little bit about like Frankenstein or Frankenstein Jr., but don't worry about it. Do your best at putting the body back together again. You know, often in the hospital, they would have removed that piece and removed this piece, but I want to put it all back together again. We don't do skin grafts. We let your body bring skin back. You know, I was told with this hand right here that I had fourth degree burns onto the bone, that I'd never have skin again. And in 30 days, I had plenty of skin. So just put the parts back together like this. Let me tell you something. If you would have gone with this wound to the hospital,
they probably would have cut this piece off right here and just eliminated it. And you'd end up having a hole in your finger, and then they'd be stitching this area to this area, and it would be too tight where it didn't belong. And this is a hospital job right here. You got a freaking mess. My way is the best way, my friends, and you can do it at home. You can put your body back together. Now I'd like to talk a little bit about treating fractures and broken bones, or any time a bone in the body is injured. Now, a fracture is just when the bone gets stressed to the point where it splits a little bit in an area. Okay, a broken bone is more serious, and of course you can have a compound fracture where the bone is just separated. Usually in the case of a compound fracture, you're probably going to want to get trauma, surgery, hospitalization, get this bone put back together. But not always. I mean, and still in many primitive areas of the world, they have bone setters who soak your bone and your body in herbs, your leg or your arm or wherever the bone is broken, with herbs like arnica and calendula and the herbs that are in my deep tissue oil and ointment. But generally speaking, in this country, most people seek trauma, medical, emergency help at that point. But many times, or the vast majority of times, an injury, a fractured bone, is only a small fracture. And it is not necessary to go to the hospital for a fractured bone. Often you can tell that you have a fracture because you have a lot of pain and you have a lot of swelling in the area. First, with a fracture or any type of broken bone, you want to start out with ice immediately. Make your ice bag. Again, crush the ice, wet it, get it really cold, and get it right on that area. That's going to relieve the pain right away and keep the swelling in check so it doesn't get totally out of control. But swelling isn't your enemy. Remember, the things that the body does, it's doing to heal and repair you. And that's why it's swelling, because swelling immobilizes the area. Pain keeps you from using the area. So pain and swelling are important parts of the healing process. But go ahead and use your ice. And the next thing you want to do is aid that swelling by immobilizing the area even more. Now, one of the ways you can do it is just with some cardboard and some duct tape or electrical tape. I'm going to show you here with my arm. So just imagine that my arm was fractured right here from a fall on roller skates or whatever. Well, just find some good corrugated cardboard and make sure the corrugations are running this way, or they're running the same way as the area of your body, and then just fold it up, okay? And do the same with the other side. Just fold it up, just like this, and bring it right together. Okay, now we've made a splint just with corrugated cardboard. Now, I'm doing this on myself, so it's a little more difficult. So I'm going to apply some pieces of tape to begin, at least so I can get it started. And duct tape doesn't always behave, but that's okay. Again, this doesn't have to look pretty. And now I'm going to put my arm back in it and close it up. And I'm going to have to hold it myself here and get that tape over on it. Now, the first piece of tape might not be perfect. No problem. Get that splint in tight and get it on. Okay, now if I want it even tighter, that's not a problem now because I already got it initially on. Okay, so now I can close it down tight and wrap it up even more. In fact, didn't behave. Duct tape has a mind of its own sometimes, and it doesn't always behave. But you can get it on and close it up really, really tight and put it down. And now you have a splint. And the best thing about this splint, my friends, is you can take it off when you need it. In fact, sometimes splints, you can just slip off an area like this. And the important thing is, because you're going to want to put ice on that area, and you're going to want to put your deep tissue oil and your deep tissue ointment on this area to get it to heal back up, because we have the bone healers in there of arnica
and calendula. And so we want to heal this area, and we're going to want to do hot and cold the next couple days on this area. And we're going to want to get some great body work done on our hand to move the energy. And you can't do that with a plaster cast on. If you ever have a cast put on, make sure it's a removable cast, not a plaster cast, a horrible thing, because you can't heal the area. And now we can go in and work and do our hot and cold. We can put on our herbal ointments like the deep tissue oil and ointment. We can get body work on this area, and we can build another cast or put this cast, well, there we go. We can put this cast back on anytime we want. Obviously, you would have someone else doing this, and you wouldn't be trying to do it yourself. But just with a little duct tape and cardboard, and if you needed the cast to be stronger, like if it's on your leg, you can use a couple layers of corrugated cardboard. You can even use pieces of wood as splints and put them on top of the cardboard and make your cast that way. But I want to tell you a couple stories here. The vast majority of time you have a bone fracture. It's what's called a green stick fracture or a little splint. Doctors aren't going to do anything for it anyway. They're going to give you an x-ray. They're going to say you have a fracture. They're going to put a cast on you that may not be able to be removed. And that's it. They're going to tell you to go home. You know, they might give you some anti-inflammatories, or they might do worse. They might decide to do surgery. You know, recently, I had a friend that had a fracture skiing. We were all skiing together, and she fell down and fractured her tibia, the top of her tibia in her leg. She went to emergency, and I looked at the x-rays, and sure enough, she had a little fracture in the top of her tibia. She went to see an orthopedic doctor, and the orthopedic doctor said, you know what, just rest, immobilize the area, and it's going to all come back together just fine. Your body knows how to heal and repair you. But they weren't satisfied, so they went to a second doctor, and the second orthopedic surgeon said the same thing. Look, don't worry. It's a small fracture. Just immobilize the area, and you'll be fine in a few weeks, a month and a half. But they weren't satisfied. They went to a third orthopedic doctor, and I think they were going to continue till they found a doctor that was going to do surgery. Well, finally, the third doctor said, well, it could heal on its own, but you could lose a little bit of the mobility in the joint, so we better do surgery. And of course, that's what they did. Now, what do you think you would do if you lost a little bit of mobility in a joint? I would suggest after the area heals, stretch, do some yoga. You can get that mobility back. It's nothing to worry about. But doctors are famous for making a big deal out of something that isn't. So I've dealt with so many patients that have fractured bones. All you do is use some ice, use your deep tissue, immobilize the area, get back in there with hot and cold after 24 hours and some body work. Immediately start juice fasting. I think with any injury, it's best to go off solid food and just drink juices. Make your fresh organic vegetable juices and your fresh organic fruit juices. This is going to build your bones back up. All that natural calcium in the carrot juice, that's the white foam on top. Drink your juices. Get your nutrition, do some bowel cleansing, use this as a time to really heal your body, and the next thing you know, your bones will be growing back just fine. Now I'd like to go over some additional herbal formula that you can use for first aid, how to use them, some of the applications, and you might consider having some of these formula around also. Besides the anti-infection formula, which we covered, and the cayenne tincture and powder, which can stop bleeding and wake people up and keep them from passing out, and besides the nerve formula to relax someone, to sedate them when we have trauma, and the deep tissue oil and ointment to use on the body to reduce inflammation, increase circulation, and the jojoba and tea tree oil and ointment, let me talk about the other products and how you would use them in a first aid application. I know sometimes we don't think of constipation necessarily as a first aid application, but certainly appendicitis is. And all appendicitis is if you look it up, is a fecalith or a piece of fecal matter obstructing the lumen or the beginning or the opening of the appendix. So the first thing you need to do is get your bowel working.
And on another DVD, I'll talk about my appendicitis program. But sometimes constipation and everything all the way to appendicitis can be very, very traumatic. And you want to get the bowel material out of you right away. And the two ways I would do that, one would be my intestinal formula number one, maximum strength. And the other one would be my bowel flush shot. You can use both of these to get the contents of your bowel, everything that's in your bowel, out the very next day. Now, sometimes your emergency can be food poisoning. Food poisoning can be horrible. It can go all the way to salmonella poisoning and very serious poisoning where you have serious diarrhea, like 20 bowel movements a day, and you're losing a lot of liquid, you're being dehydrated, you're in extreme abdominal pain. And that's where intestinal formula number two becomes a very wonderful emergency and first aid medicine for food poisoning. And you want to take 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 doses. Make sure you take it with plenty of water. Now, you can also take the capsules, but if I have serious food poisoning, I like to use the straight powder because you can use a lot more and you don't have to swallow that many capsules. A real important one when you're traveling, in fact, I like this 24-hour bowel detox kit. I always throw a couple of these in my luggage. Wherever I go around the world, you have some intestinal formula number one and some intestinal formula number two in here, and you can use that anytime you're traveling and you have some suspect water or suspect food. You go, oh God, because let me tell you, the dysentery, the diarrhea, the intestinal pain, the weakness, the dehydration that can come, I mean, a big population of the world that dies from dysentery. Okay, so especially if you're traveling to Asia or India or Africa, but even to Mexico or the Caribbean, just about anywhere. Hey, there's some places of America where I wouldn't drink the water either. Make sure you have something with you to absorb the poisons and the toxins, like the intestinal formula number two. Now, also, most people don't think of indigestion as being a trauma or an emergency situation, but I've seen people with indigestion that were in more pain than people having a heart attack. So the one thing that is really wonderful is the digestive shot. You knock the whole, shake it up and knock the whole shot back. And pretty much if we're talking indigestion, gas, heartburn, colic, cramps, digestive pain, nausea, it's going to fix it all. It's a wonderful formula. And let me tell you, my friends, acid reflux, indigestion, horrible gas can be a real emergency. You want to look at having some Echinacea Plus around. Sometimes you get bee stings, a lot of bee stings. I was riding my motorcycle once and all of a sudden I felt a lot of heat right between my thighs, right between my legs. I pulled over the motorcycle. I thought it was gas or there was a fire. And I had gone through a swarm of bees and about 30 of them went right in the side of my thighs and they all bit me at once. Well, very soon after that, I could feel the swelling. I could feel my throat closing. I drank a whole bottle of Echinacea Plus. Let me tell you that Echinacea is specific for any toxic or poisonous bee stings, wasp stings, spider bites, scorpion bites. You take it internally. You can also put it on the area. Echinacea Plus should be part of any first aid kit. Also, gallbladder attacks. Many people have gallbladder attacks. You rush into the hospital, they have their gallbladder removed. They have a cholecystectomy. You know, almost all cholecystectomies aren't necessary. In fact, let's go as far as to say that all of them aren't. Every patient that I had that came to see me with gallbladder pain and a stuffed gallbladder, I was able to clear their gallbladder out and get them well again using liver flushes and using my liver gallbladder formula. In fact, I had patients that were in the hospital ready to have that surgery, and I told them, check themselves out of the hospital, run out of the hospital if necessary, get to my clinic, and with liver flushes and liver gallbladder tonic, they got to save their gallbladder. They didn't have to have any surgery, and their gallbladder was working fine. So liver flushes and liver gallbladder tonic for any type of gallbladder problem or liver problem. Now, additionally, a lot of people have serious bladder and kidney infections, and my kidney bladder tonic works 100%. and 2% of the time. I've never ever had it fail in the clinic at destroying any type of bladder or kidney infection. And if you think that's not an emergency, and you meet someone that's had a great bladder infection, they're on their knees crying in pain. So it can be a serious emergency. If it's cold and flu season, my cold and flu shot. You want to prevent cold and flus, and if you think you have one, you want to knock it out quick. Do you know that a lot of people die in America every year from colds and influenza? So if you think you're going to get rid of it before it hurts you. Another herbal tonic for emergencies is a lung tonic. The lobelia in the lung tonic, the lobeline in the lobelia, dilates your bronchioles. It opens them right up. So if anyone's having a problem breathing, like an asthmatic attack, or they have bronchitis, or pneumonia, use the lung tonic. If they have emphysema, use the lung tonic. Open those, dilate up those bronchioles, and they'll be breathing again. That can be a life-threatening emergency. Now, ladies, I know menstrual problems, menopausal, hot flashes, and anxiety attacks can be an emergency. And PMS can be a serious emergency. So utilizing my female tonic and my female plus formula, this can end the hot flash immediately, the anxiety attack immediately. Again, some people don't think they're life-threatening emergencies, but I have seen hormone imbalances make my ladies lose their jobs and destroy their marriages and have their kids move out of the house. That's an emergency to me. And those herbal tonics balance your hormones and bring your life back. Now, for you men that wake up and you can't pee, if you can't pee for a few days, you die, my friend. And benign prostate disease is so huge in America. Don't forget the prostate tonic. It can save someone from having a horrible prostatectomy or prostate surgery. Now, if someone has a heart attack, I had people have heart attacks right in my clinic. Don't forget the heart tonic, and you bring in the cayenne tincture immediately. I've seen many people come right out of a heart attack by using the heart tonic. And also, if someone's having a stroke, you can use the brain tonic along with the heart tonic and along with the cayenne tincture to drive more oxygen and blood up to the brain. I have saved people's lives who were having heart attacks and having strokes using the heart tonic and cayenne and the brain tonic and cayenne. So don't forget about it, my friends. That's a life-threatening emergency. Now, a lot of times around the house, people get things in their eyes. They're working in the tool room or they're cutting the lawn. And let me tell you, you do not want to have a scratched cornea. So the best thing to do is flush out your eye. You can flush it out with water, but why use just water when you can use herbs with it? Like my Eye Bright tonic. The herbs in the Eye Bright tonic are going to disinfect the eye. They're going to clean out the eye. They act as a natural astringent. It's a beautiful thing to do, and you can use between 1 and 10 drops of the Eye Bright tonic in with some purified or distilled water, and then wash that eye out good, flush it out good, and get any debris out of it. Now, some of you that have had toothaches and lost a tooth can be an emergency. You can clean out and disinfect the whole area of your gums and the teeth using the tooth and gum. And if you keep a little clove oil around, that works beautifully for any severe dental pain. Last but not least, my bug block and bug barrier. Let's not get bit in the first place. So you can use the bug block around your house to keep the bugs away. It'll keep the mosquitoes away, the bees, the flies. You know, flies carry more E. coli bacteria and land on your food and cause more food poisoning and dysentery around the world than anything else. It's the flies being on other people's fecal waste and then being on your food. I know that's disgusting, but that's how it happens. And you can stop the flies from getting around you with the bug block. So take it, especially when you travel around the world, but you're not poisoning yourself with DDT or some organophosphates or something that's going to cause nerve damage or kill your liver. You're using 100% essential oils. And the bug barrier is great too, to put it right on your body so you don't get bit. And if you have been bit, it's going to stop the itching. Now, a lot of people might not think that a mosquito bite is a serious emergency, but think about it, my friends. It's proven that mosquitoes carry parasites, and they can carry disease, and they can carry viruses, like the West Nile virus. Now, I think they could carry any virus, and AIDS is a virus, so you don't want to get bit a lot by mosquitoes. So, my friends, use the bug block. Now, a big part of herbal treatment for first aid emergencies is using your imagination. We know this draws, formula two draws incredibly out of your colon. Well, it also draws on your body. So if you have an area of your body that you need to clean and draw material out, or like a poisonous bite or sting, you can go ahead and mix this up with water or 50% water and apple cider vinegar, make it to a thick paste and put it right on the body. And you're going to draw whatever poison is in there out. But a big part is using your imagination. Remember, you can handle anything at home. Just have a lot of herbs around, have your tools, and use your imagination. Friends, I've given you a lot of information about first aid and emergencies and how to handle them yourself. So I hope this has been really educational and empowering to you to stay away from doctors and drugs and hospitals unless it's absolutely necessary. I want to really let you know that you can do this. You can handle this. I have put thousands of people back together again using these simple methods right in my kitchen, right in my bathrooms all the time. And they don't have scars. Their bones healed. They're all well. They're back together. So you can do this. The first time you do it, you might be a little shaky, but like anything, practice makes perfect. So don't be afraid. Just take a deep breath, build your first aid kit, and have your herbs around before the emergency hits. Be prepared. Maybe even do a few emergency drills so you know where everything is. But I want you to know that you can save a lot of the expense and the drama and the trauma and the helplessness that you'll feel if you rush to the hospital emergency room. You can handle it. You can deal with emergencies and do your first aid at home.